the name above all names.
Yeah.
Let no chapter 5, Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. You see, New Testament saints had to be steadfast. They couldn't give in to the first sign of rejection. One of the problems that I think the corporate church, especially the corporate church in America, has fallen prey to is the fact that she wants to be accepted across all social norms. That's contrary to what Jesus said. Jesus said, you will be hated by all men for my name's sake. But he that endures to the end shall be saved. Again, he said in Matthew chapter 24, you will be hated of all nations for my name's sake. Why? Because the world hates truth. You will be rejected for being a truth bearer. When the opposite is always the case, when you are always carrying around a bunch of lies, people will flock to you. Because people would rather hear a lie than to know the truth. New Testament saints had to be steadfast because they knew their time was short. They knew that the religious and the political climate was exactly right for the seeds of the gospel to be planted in all the four corners of the earth. The old saying that all roads led to Rome was true, but those roads that led to Rome was also the roads that carried the gospel into all the known world at that time. They knew they had to strike while the iron was hot, and they could not give into any sense of rejection. Jesus even told them, if you go into a place and they reject you, just wipe your feet and keep on going.
That's right. Right. Yep.
Paul would write to the Corinthian church and say, be in steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain. Jesus never stopped doing what is right because he was rejected. And neither can you, my brothers and sisters. You cannot let up and give in because somebody rejects you, rejects your message, rejects truth. It's not about you. It's about him. Just keep on going on. I don't know about you, but recently I've wondered, and over the past year especially, I've wondered, and the question has come up not only in my mind, but in conversation. Why do we not see the miracles today like that in the New Testament? Has anybody ever asked that question?
Yes.
The default answer has always been because we lack faith. But I brought that response into question of like that perhaps it's not even about faith. Maybe we don't see the miracles, not because we don't have faith to believe, but because we don't have the guts to stand against the controversy and the rejection and the scrutiny that comes when God divinely begins to move. Because let me tell you, if people begin to raise from the dead all over this place, news will get out. And CNN and NBC and CBS, they'll all come. And they'll want to put us on the spot. They'll want to put scrutiny. They'll want to twist it to make us doubt and to make us think that it's not the miraculous. And are we able to stand up and boldly defend what Jesus Christ is and what his word says and what he does against the onslaught of the world?
Yeah.
got to be steadfast against rejection. Secondly, we've got to be strong. We've got to maintain strength in order to overcome the inevitable rejection that Jesus said his followers would experience. Jesus himself knew the cross was before him, and he would have to face it with strength, not cowardice. This is why he said that in his word that we should love the Lord our God with our whole heart, with our whole soul, with all of our strength, with all of our mind, and our neighbor as ourself. Jesus himself in the garden would pray that the cup would pass from him, but yet in that garden he received the strength to complete the work that he was called and sent to do, the work of redemption. My friends, you and I must likewise pray for strength in order to maintain our course in these last days. Not only does the spirit of the Antichrist want to divide the church, he wants to cause her to be weak and anemic. We must rise up not in our strength, but not by power, not by might, but by the Spirit of the living God. No time to fret, because as he told the apostle Paul, so we receive these same words, that his grace is sufficient, and that his strength is made perfect in our weakness. I believe it's time for the church to lay down her prideful arrogance and humble herself before the Lord and say, let the weak say, I am strong, not because of the church of all, but not because of us. Some gift of the Spirit, but because I live in him, I can have strength to overcome. Yeah. In each scripture, Revelation 3:8 to the church at Philadelphia, these words are written, I know your works, and I've set before you an open door, and no man can shut it. He said, you have a little strength, and have kept my word and have not denied my name. Just a little bit of strength, a little bit of his strength at work in us will make you an overcomer. Isaiah said, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Instead of waiting for some brother or some sister to come to your rescue, or some preacher to anoint you, or some prophet to his charisma in the way that he carried himself before men. In all of these ways, David was inferior to Saul, except for the fact that David was excellent in humility. In submission, even when he knew he was guilty, he submitted to God. And when he had opportunity to kill Saul, he reverenced the position of the king and acted in humility and submission instead of a crazed, egomaniac who wanted the position. He felt rejection from the time of his childhood when his own father brought all of his other brothers in as possible parents and totally overlooked the possibility that he might be the one chosen. Now that's a pretty tough pill to swallow. And we might carry that around all of our lives and keep murmuring and complaining because what Mama and Dad did 50 years ago. We still have all of these hang-ups. Guess what? Mom and Dad were just as naive when they were raising you as you are raising your children. Get over it. Submit to God. And say, God, it doesn't matter if the world accepts me. It doesn't matter if the church accepts me. It doesn't matter if those that I work with accept me. It doesn't matter if my spouse accepts me. It doesn't matter what the world says or does, I'm going to submit myself completely to you. I'm going to rise up in your strength, and I'm going to declare to be steadfast until your return. Submission to God will give you the mental prowess to overcome rejection. We can never lose sight of the fact that Jesus is the King. People have a hard time with submission because everybody wants to be the ruler. We can't have submission in our families because, hey, he don't know how to act. I'm going to rule this roost. arms are always open. They're always standing at the door, and all we have to do is knock. Open that door. You said you would come in. So you would have sweet fellowship, and if the world rejects you, so be it. Our life in this world is just a vapor. It's just a short stint. And even if we live to be 100 years old, what is 100 years in comparison to eternity? Lord, let us bear up under the rejection of this life, knowing that we have eternal life in your presence, where we will never be rejected. I give you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. Right now, would you stand with me? You're here to stand. You don't know Jesus. You're here and you realize you're a failure. You've been rejected by employers, you've been rejected by family, you've been rejected by society. You may have even been rejected by some religious. Tell you, if you were fully surrendered to God, you were all Jesus. Today is the day, as they sing one verse and one chorus, I want you to come. If you need divine healing, I want you to come. If you need to be filled with the Spirit of God, if you need the baptism of the Holy Ghost, I want you to come.
Jesus Christ.
place.